very much. Welcome to the session on technology innovations. My name is Suki Choi, and I just left the academic world and the public healthcare sector, which I've been working for 10 years, to start my second company within IT, and this time within actually care, elderly care and healthcare. So this topic is in particular intriguing for me. So we quite know the big message that we are getting older and older. But the question is, how can we live better? Technology is obviously a hot candidate, and to shed light on this topic, I'm really delighted to introduce Professor Sarah Zaja, Dr. Joe Coughlin, like coughing, sorry, and then you have Dr. Sarah Masur, and also Professor Sarah Harper. So let's start with the first question. We're all surrounded with Twitter, Google, FaceTime, Apple, Instagram, the list can go on. It sounds a bit young. And honestly, I am really curious about how the corporate headquarters, Sarah, are reasoning. You have been working at Ericsson, as I understand, on quite high level for almost 20 years. So could you please share what are the discussions behind the doors, the strategic ones? Do you prioritize the young or the elderly?
Well, our vision is to empower all people by using new technology, both old and young. And I don't think that there is anything in the basic technology that is actually different. It's kind of age agnostic. Then it depends on the applications that you use it for. And I would say that with the development that we've had in recent years with smartphones, tablets, apps, technology has become easier to use and more intuitive for all ages.
All right.
And we have also done a study recently where we have seen that the use of technology among older people is actually a way of bridging the gap between generations.
Okay, could you give a concrete example of that?
Yeah, they meet their children, the grandchildren, and together they work on the technology that they can use for communication within the family and the near friends.
Okay, such as FaceTime and so.
FaceTime, yeah. Using tablets.
So, Joe, you are much into this field as well, so do you agree with the view that technology is today actually approaching all segments?
I think that technology developers, whether they're in the laboratory, in industry or academia, are attempting to develop technologies that are accessible by older adults. But I think we, and I'll use the royal we, make a critical mistake. We have this vision of making an old man's telephone or an old man's car, which I can guarantee you the following, that a young man or a young woman won't buy it, but I can also guarantee you that an old man or an old woman will not buy it. And what we're lacking is not technology, but frankly, imagination, about not developing a new widget or a new app or something, but what's the vision to excite and delight the consumer at any age? Engineers are designed to fill requirements. We have yet to envision what the requirements of that exciting old age is going to be, and something that can be used from beginning of life to the end of life. The one that comes close, and I know it's become a trite example, is iPad. You know, I like my iPad for a variety of reasons, but I particularly like it because I can take off my glasses, crank up the font, be able to see it, and no one's going to accuse me of using an old man's device, but I have old man attributes on there, so I can be able to see it. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to age by stealth, not by three buttons at a time.
Okay. So, Sarah, do you agree?
Yes, I think something that's important is we try and design for usability for across the lifespan. Sometimes that's difficult to achieve, but I think a big part of that is to think about an example that Joe just brought up, which is adaptability within the technology system, so that it can be adjusted to the needs of different user populations without necessarily changing the device itself, what it looks like in the larger sense.
So it sounds like we can have the same core technology, but the applications could be varied. All right. Seems like we have a consensus here. And we have also another question that we posted in the program, and that is actually maybe the even more important question. How can technology improve the lives of the elderly? And actually, I have some favorite examples that I want to share with you, just to show you the well, the breadth and width of the technology. And it's kind of a coincidence it, they all come from Asia. Anyway, so in South Korea, you have robots helping out elderly, and they are doing a lot of duties in the whole, household. In Japan, we actually saw the example of toilets. Actually, they have this, for example, function of going up and down the seats. So it means that it just doesn't only help the functional need, it also helps to make the person keep their privacy. So there is an integrity need as well that you're addressing. There's also in Singapore sensors integrated to clothes, so it means that they actually signal and predict when you have to go to the toilet. So it means that you don't need to go into embarrassing situations, but also it's a functional need. And finally, I would say that we all know with the applications booming that we have memory training, we have language applications, we have, well, reminding your parents to take the medicine. So it's actually facing the cognitive needs. So these are some, you know, basic applications. And I know that you, Sarah, have been really working with translating research into applications and also looked into elderly's interaction with technology. Could you please give them?
Yes, we just finished a large study, in fact, where we designed a software application that was a little easier to use. And we put in computers in the homes of seniors who lived alone and were isolated. They were aged 65 to 98 years. And we are getting some very nice results in terms of it enhancing social support, connectivity, reconnecting, as you said, with family members, friends, revisiting through the internet cities where they used to live. So it's been, I think, a very positive study in terms of showing the potential role that technology can play in enhancing the lives of older people. But I think one thing that we can't lose sight of is we have to ensure that people have meaningful access to technology. And that's not necessarily true for all segments of the older population.
Sarah, do you have any comment on, you know,
well, in actual fact, on this last comment, because, and I just want to tell you or share with you a story. So a couple of weeks ago, I was at a wonderful, big, flashy corporate conference in London with Apple, and they were telling us about the latest technology and about the Internet of Things and how we were all going to get these wonderful monitors and every older person would be able to have one. And a few days later, I went with a government inquiry, and we went to Margate, which is a very small seaside town. And we had a room, probably with slightly less than this amount of people, just local people. And we were talking to them about the fact that we were doing this inquiry into the aging of the UK population. And how should we communicate with them? How about email? And they went, no, sorry, not email. How about a letter or a flyer or the local radio? And these people were absolutely adamant. They hadn't even got access to broadband or wireless. And the juncture of these two conferences really made me think that we have the scientists who are really pushing ahead with really fabulous technology. But the real crux is that even in the advanced economies, we have large percentages of all the population, let alone older, frailer, disadvantaged people, who really are not going to get access to the latest technology. And that, I think, is really where there's a huge debate that's needed.
Okay. So do you have any, well, spontaneous comment on how to address this gap? Obviously, the technology is there, but how can you make this accessible?
Well, I think, you know, in some respects it is a policy issue because there are even neighborhoods in Miami where internet is not available or the broadband is not of sufficient strength to... that's needed for a lot of applications. We did a study with family caregivers where we were bringing technology programs to the caregivers using technology media because many caregivers can't get out and access programs in the community. And surprisingly, the technology required internet access, and we naively assumed that our caregivers would have internet access in their homes, and not one single caregiver had internet. So we had to actually install it for them before we could actually use the caregiving application that we had developed.
All right, so, and this was in the U.S., Miami?
Yes, this is in the U.S.
So you might have some new
business. These were poorer populations, lower socioeconomic status.
Okay. So I would like to ask if anyone in the audience have a question to this panel? Please. Professor Uxula, yes?
Yeah. Sure. Thank you. So, technology is an amazing invention of the human mind, and it has been very helpful in the past. It will be very helpful in the future. Given what we know about the aging process, I'm asking the experts on the panel, how can we make sure to balance the supportive function of technology with the training and the challenging function of technology? Because there's one problem to technology, and actually the car is one piece of technology that highlights my point. The car is a fascinating invention, obviously. Where would we be without the car? At the same time, the car has created a lot of problems. Yes. Because it has disincentivized us to walk. And we are made to walk. We are a species that is supposed to be walking 15 kilometers per day, 10 miles per day. So I'm saying we have to be mindful that we do not create technologies that at the first sight are very helpful. They make an easier living. But in the second step, they are creating disuse and thereby loss of functioning. And so I think finding a balance between supportive functions and continue to challenge us, which then has a lot to do with tailorizing the technology, having so-called intelligence technology, what Sarah mentioned before, so that it reacts to the user and can actually learn where is the user now and what does the user need, you know, to stay engaged and so forth. So I would like maybe one round of comments on that.
Very good. I think, Joe, you want to comment on that?
My lab started in the issue of older drivers, which is somewhere trapped between humor and horror, depending on the story at hand. But we're working on how do you create high-performance environments, beginning with a car, but ultimately with a home and workplace, and that is, how do you have an environment that is able to sense, are you stressed, are you fatigued, are you performing within your range, but then having interventions to bring you up if you're fatigued, bring you down if you're stressed. And that's irrelevant of birthday. One of the things that we're going to have to do about an aging society is really eliminate the discussion that birthdays predict. They predict very badly, particularly around older driver accidents. Health conditions do. And so as a result, we now have to start to redefine the issue of longevity and aging to be about performance. And I guess just the last thing is a footnote. Does anyone know what you call technology that's difficult for an older adult to use?
Nope.
Bad technology.
Okay.
You know, it is the only industry and research community in the world that blames the consumer. You know, say, well, you know, those old people or my father or my mother, they would never quite use that. And then they come out with these ingenious devices that have three buttons on a telephone. Look at the room here. How many of you would feel very proud that if your adult child gave you a button and said, me, the ambulance, and the fire department? And yet this is heralded as a great device. No, that's called a designer's cop-out. Work harder.
So one question, I'm just wondering that, you know, we have a generation gap. I think that those who are born today, they might be more used to iPads. How do you comment on that? Or will this kind of be something that will be value for them as well?
I'll let somebody else weigh in, but that one, all right, I feel very passionate about that. I'm looking at the age demographics of this room. Yeah. You are going to age faster than my group and my parents, because you're pretty young out there. But you know why? You're the digerati. You're the technically literate. The difference is the technology is moving faster than it's ever moved before. So by age 30, people are going to be looking at you a little funny going, well, I'll give you an example. We did a study in the lab. We're already finding that 25-year-olds are getting made fun of by the 10-year-olds. Why? Because all those 25-year-olds, they insist on touching their phone and swiping. The 10-year-olds, if I can't talk to you, I'm not going to touch it. So you've already gotten older and you didn't even know it. So no, so technology is advancing so quickly that aging is an issue.
Sarah?
Yes, I agree. I think it's going to remain a question. I mean, technology by definition is something that changes and is dynamic. So what we're looking at today is going to be very different from what we're looking at in the future.
Yeah?
I would like to comment on the comment from the professor or the question from the professor. I think it depends on how we use technology. And for instance, communication is a basic need.
So we shouldn't use technology to replace communication between people, but rather to enhance it. For instance, if you have difficulties in traveling, maybe you can still travel virtually, or you can attend a theater or a concert, still being in your home, but have the full experience. Or even you can have a dinner with your friends. Even though you're not physically around the same table, you could be virtually around the same table. And when it comes to walking, I think many older people are afraid of leaving their home because they're afraid that they will fall down or have an accident or get lost. But with technology, we can make them feel safe even outside the home. They can be tracked. They can have automatic emergency call if something happens. And that will maybe make them walk even more.
So it still sounds like technology is a very hot candidate for actually taking on some of the challenges of aging.
Yes, I think it is, but I think we have to think about it in terms of how technology can support successful and productive aging. I don't think it can really be a substitution. I think it has to be thought of more in the context, the kind of socio-technical model, systems model, as one part of the model, but not the only piece of the model.
That in fact, I mean, technology is going to change all aspects of our lives, and the aging of the population is something that is running alongside it. And as Joe said, we shouldn't really be thinking of technology for old people. Everyone is going to face technology, and the cohort you were born into, your socioeconomic background, your educational experience, that's all going to interface in a different way with technology. And maybe the only thing is whether you're using technology for your work or for your leisure or for your healthcare, but that can happen at all ages. So that's right. How I think we should be framing it.
Okay.
Completely agree.
Mm. Yes. And just to make a comment on the Oxla, is that we can see that a lot of robots, of course, are sold in Japan and South Korea, for example, and that also comes to that strike of balance, because if you have them helping, but that would reduce the physical exercise they might need. So that's, I think, a good point you made.
So it would be nice to think about a robot who requires to work together.
A personal trainer. Okay, that's a new business idea.
Turn the question on its head. Why are we focusing in on a single cohort? And what I mean by that is that wouldn't it be a better business model to get these things in people's lives by saying, what is caring, convenient, cool, and affordable in middle age? So I sneak these devices and systems and services in your home when you need them, and they just happen to be there when you're 75, 85, whatever it might be. Because I'm really concerned about the notion of developing systems specifically for older adults. You know, personal emergency response systems or social systems, social alarms as we call them in Europe, the help I fall and can't get up buttons. In the United States, they're about the price of cable TV, pretty affordable. And they're very simple to use, so it's not a matter of usability, and it's not that much on cost. But the entire penetration rate of the 65-plus who needs it, 3%. In the UK, the NHS will pay for it by simply saying, you're a little frail. The penetration rate, again, goes up to 12%. We've got to be careful we don't build buttons that we put on our bracelets and our jackets that says, old man walking. We have to create a lifestyle first and then have the engineer step in and say, okay, how do you facilitate this?
Yeah, and that's a very good point, because when it comes to the knees, you kind of see the similarities of actually, sorry to say, disabled people, but also children, like infants, both infants and very old people wear diapers. So it's that kind of a synergy that you, for example, within Ericsson have looked into, or how do you separate the synergies of actually approaching several segments at the same time?
Well, I think there are a lot of synergies. Like we talked about the intuitive use, for instance, of a tablet. It's intuitive both for elder people, but also for very small children. And the ones that maybe have the biggest problems were the ones in my generation that were trained to command program a computer. That is not so intuitive.
Yeah, if you know what a fax machine is, you're dated.
Yeah. So it seems like we agree on taking down the stigma focus on the aging to a certain cohort, right?
Well, yeah. I think we've learned that from the original work that was done on assistive devices. Simple things like grab bars, even people who need them don't want to necessarily put them in their homes because they are stigmatizing. So I think that's the point Joe is kind of getting at when he's talking about old man kind of button.
Yeah. So just one more question on this theme. Do you think there is opportunity now to redefine the age? And that means that going from the passport chronic age more to looking into the biology, I mean, the age of your body, depending on what you eat and how you exercise. And also we talked about cognitive age, which has to do with the mental age of how you perceive yourself, but also how fast you actually can process information. Is that something that you have any reflections on, how to define age?
But surely the whole thing is that we don't want to do that. We want to say, you know, that there are adults and adults are independent and they have certain needs and they're productive and contributory. Mm-hmm. And then at certain stages of our life, not all of us, we may become dependent and therefore we will need health and frailty needs. But it's, I don't think we should be saying, thinking of the elderly, we're just thinking that adults want to use technology in different ways and that it will evolve. And therefore, it isn't so much even that we should be doing it at midlife. Technology is something that we will learn as we are when we are children, and throughout our lives we'll be using it in different and flexible ways. I think that's the way we should be framing it.
I mean, essentially, if you think about the way technology is developing today and how it's being focused on older adults, you've never thought about your grandparents being lifestyle leaders. You know, we're always looking at the 20-year-olds with smartphones, but between smart toilets, robots, and systems to advise you on how to eat, you're being monitored, managed, and motivated at age 80. That's basically a lifestyle that no one else of any other age would tolerate, and yet we're framing the technology to watch your every movement. So we have to really rethink how we're using these technologies, because technology doesn't help you do something better. It changes fundamentally what you do.
Okay, thank you very much. We will now actually invite you, audience, including actually a digital audience we have here, to come with questions. So please, I will start with the global online audience.
I think we have real people who have been waiting.
Okay, let's go with that.
So far we've been talking a lot about devices, right? External devices and how that technology will help us. What about technology that is incorporated into the body, right? So that is a side that I've been reading a lot, and we have not talked enough. So what are your thoughts about eventually having technology replace organs or doing things that actually really delay aging or transform the notion of aging into something very different?
Very good question. Anyone?
Well, I think certainly there are a lot of possibilities, and I know that that's being talked a lot about as technologies for the future. I think we're a long way off yet from achieving some of that in terms of realities. I think we have to look at those systems and more systematically, and again, I think tailoring is going to be very important, that those are matched to an individual's needs. And I think that's something that we have to really consider, and also questions of accessibility. One concern that we have is, you know, there's some notion that these technologies are going to be easily and readily available for everyone, and I don't want to paint a big bleak picture, but in fact that's not yet the reality, and so we have to be careful that we don't increase or create a world of have and have-nots in the sphere of technology.
But having said that, I think that's exactly the way to think about it. Right. So often when we talk about aging populations and technology, we think of assisted living, and yet the debate needs to be exactly what you're talking about, that, you know, we start with nanotechnology and stem cell research, and we go through the Internet of Things, and we look at robotics. You know, it's everything that we're going to be experiencing going forward will impact and have implications for the aging of the population. So I think that's the right way to look at it.
Okay.
But I don't think it's only for the aging. I
mean, not at all.
Children that are born deaf can suddenly hear by use of technology, or maybe see in the future, and that is fantastic.
It's also going to put a very fine resolution on questions around privacy, a question around social contract. I mean, think about some of the colleagues we heard speak this morning about genetic research. What happens if before you're born, I do a check to find out how well you chose your parents, and you've got a proclivity to type 2 diabetes, and I give you a smartphone and an app to choose how you eat and exercise, and then you wake up one day at age 65 and you ignored all my advice and you're a type 2 diabetic because you ate too much of something and you chose your parents badly. what's my social contract to you? The government, private insurance, family, do I still have to pay for your bad behavior? That is coming. We're now going to have knowledge and systems to enforce and monitor that we've never had before. And the elderly will be the first, shall we say, test project of how that new ethnic, how that new ethical and policy discussion takes place.
So if you would like to have one policy that you would like to send to the future government regarding this, what would that be?
I think the first thing would be don't get in the way. I think the second thing is to, frankly, put aging on the agenda. My colleague from Ericsson, and you're here. Most companies are still designing technologies for 5'10", 167 pounds. Sorry for the English. 27-year-old males. Let alone older adults. When the future of the world is gray, small, and female. That's who we need to keep in mind.
Okay, sounds good. So now we have to let in the digital audience. They have been waiting, and please.
Hello. Referring to that of body enhancement, there are several movements right now going on, like biohacking, people like trying to enhance their bodies on their own. And I think this is going to take more strength in society as year pass by. But I wanted to direct the question to the technology companies and, of course, to the MIT research, because with more advances that we do, we are also thinking on moving on to other planets. And this is also creating new demands on how can we actually travel for so long if we cannot survive, for example, a planetary trip.
Who is the one that is addressing that question?
There were actually no questions online.
Okay.
So we had to, yeah.
Okay.
So how do you think that will companies invest on, for example, cryogenics to support life into the future or find cures that you may want to freeze down your bodies? And people are already doing this. Like there are several cases reported in California, for example, of people freezing down their bodies and trying to...
Okay, thank you very much for the question. Do you have any comment on that, or shall we go back to the earth?
In the words of the philosopher Clint Eastwood, a man's got to know his limitations. Yeah.
Thank you for the reflection. But talking about the wearables, that is something I think we should put some focus on. It's here and now, and it's really booming. You have entrepreneurs. Growing up with this, you know, you can actually measure everything from your skin temperature, heartbeat, blood pressure, respiratory rate, sleeping quality, etc. And in fact, it's happening now. And this means also that the IT wearables can meet all the needs. How do you view this upcoming wearable industry in the perspective of... all the people's needs?
Well, I think that the wearables are not just for older people. I mean, I think everybody's wearing wearables. I mean, most people I know have some kind of device that's measuring their steps or their sleep or how much physical exercise they do, and I don't think it's segmented to one population. A different type of technology that sometimes is age-focused is, of course, sensing technology, where sensors are put in the home to see if people are falling or they've had some kind of change in their functional status. Mm. And so there is a lot of work going on in that area.
So I agree with you that maybe it's more to the young people they have approached. So how many of you here have heard about Jawbone or Fitbit? Up with the hat? Okay, it's quite many. And the legal aspect has been very much discussed here. We now know that the legal act is not keeping pace with the technology development that is kind of, you know, used to. And so there is this market for collecting and selling health data, and it's booming for data brokers and hackers. Actually, also, IDC is predicting that there will be 130 million wearables sold in 2018, and the market size of $6 billion. Does this kind of, you know, game changes like Apple, Google, and Samsung, will that kind of, how will that affect the landscape in terms of game-changing and disruptive innovation?
You want to take that one?
I'm not sure it is such a big game changer, to be honest. I think it's built on that we all want to be in control. We want to know exactly how many steps are we taking, how many calories are we burning, how much are we sleeping. But maybe we should listen more to ourselves to know if we're sleeping well, if we're eating enough. Although I think it can be useful in the sense of aging, because some of that technology may enable elderly people to move a longer time in their own environment without having to move to special housing. And I think in that sense it's good, but I'm not sure it's a big game changer.
Okay. Everyone here, what do you say about this game-changing thesis that a lot of the industry is posing?
I'm not so sure it's game-changing either. I think it's just becoming ubiquitous. I think it's just becoming integrated across the lifespan into everyday living and how we live our lives and functions and the expectations that we're starting to have about how things are accomplished and achieved. So
Sarah?
Well, I mean, I was thinking again, you know, you said 160 million. We're talking about a population of about 7 billion, and we're talking about maybe 30% of that population being over 60 by 2050. And we're talking about millions and millions of people in emerging and developing countries being elderly. And therefore, this whole conversation about technology goes back to what I said at the beginning. I think a lot of it, there's this huge difference between what the high-tech companies are able to do and the access that the vast majority of people are going to have. And that, I think, is one of the problems. Although, I suppose, one of the things we haven't really spoken about is that obviously this kind of new technology and things like telecare and for doctors being able to reach out into people's homes and monitor older people. And when you think how the mobile phone has leapt from advanced economies into emerging economies and also into the least developed world, sub-Saharan Africa has a huge growth in the mobile phone. And that is being used as a medical device to monitor the health systems of, you know, an increasing number of those people. Maybe that's where really good value can come out of this technology, that you know, those people who don't have access to Western healthcare systems or, should we say, healthcare systems of advanced economies will be able to use modern technology in order to support themselves. So I see it much more in that kind of a framing.
Yeah, I completely agree to your comment.
I'm actually very optimistic on accessibility as an issue and affordability. I mean, I'm one of the not-so-bright people who bought a computer in 1985 for $5,000, and today that computer would be a better boat anchor than a processor. And you could get, you know, the same, much more power for $200. So it's getting cheaper. It's getting ubiquitous. But I think there are other barriers that we're not thinking about that are not technological, and they're the software. That is between-the-ears software. Telehealth has been around for more than 50 years, and it's gone nowhere fast. Why? Not the patient, not the caregiver, but the people who wear white coats. The doctors and the nurses have not been socialized to believe that that's part of delivering care, so as a result, they were not big promoters and adopters. As far as wearables, think of all that data. What are we going to do with it? We're not sure the pharma companies and health insurers, be they public or private, can mine it for patterns. But most of us knew we should not smoke. We know we shouldn't have had that second dessert. And yet we did. So now that your watch is beeping, are you going to put down the cheesecake? I don't think so.
Yes, Ursula.
Yes. No, it makes a big difference for a second. No, I think it's a game changer. The rest of that research, particularly in the social sciences, is the following. It's a big benefit to change behavior. If and only if you have a friend who's doing the same thing to reinforce the objective message. One more data point on my computer is just one more email. I'm going to gone.
I disagree.
We need a microphone here.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I think the variables are still in their infancy and the technology will be optimized. I'm very optimistic. But we have so much evidence from biofeedback and other streams of research that tell us that we are very reactive to that kind of reflection of what we are doing. Because after all, the most we are interested in is ourselves. And if someone is speaking to us, someone being an operating system, telling us who we are and what we are doing, we are listening. And we have to be careful how it will wear off and how we habituate to this new kind of interface. And then this has to be an intelligence technology that it will challenge us again. But I think from a public health perspective, the variables are very, very helpful. And I think it's worthwhile to invest into further developing them.
I agree with you on that, but I do think it's only going to have an impact if everyone starts wearing, call it a Fitbit, whatever the product might be, because it's less the objective information, I believe, than everyone is doing this, therefore I am going to do it too. Or like smoking. Smoking became an issue, a managed issue, I think, less because of laws than because we made it uncool.
I agree with you. That's an important component. The social component is an important component. But there's an independent feedback component, which I don't think can be denied.
Yep. No, I think I agree that the feedback component is very important. And people obviously want the feedback because they keep buying these devices. The one thing that you brought up, I think, that we really have to think about is sustainability. And people buy the device and they like it because it's new and shiny and it's a toy, but it's how long are they going to use it and how long will they keep it before they adapt and try something else.
Thank you. Sarah Musser, you wanted to say something.
I have one comment. I think the important aspect is quality of life. So it's not only supervising people, telling them not to have that second piece of cheesecake. If it really enhances the quality of life for the person, they should still have that piece of cheesecake, in my mind.
So you might need subjective parameters for each individual.
Yes.
All right. And I
technology is for enhancing life enhancing quality of life.
Defined by that person.
Life can be measured in chocolate. Yes. I'm sorry.
And again, I would like to bring in the audience. Please, can you give the microphone to someone?
Is there research on the impact of gamification for elderly people?
Sarah?
Yes, there is some research. Actually, a colleague who works with our group at Florida State is doing some of that research. And he just had some interesting data, which found that the elderly certainly are willing to play games and they're willing to use them, but the games have to be something that's of interest to them. And Tetris may not be the game that's of interest to someone who's in the later decades. So, in fact, he found that there was some lack of use of the games, and when probing and getting some qualitative data on why not, it was because the games were not fun or not meaningful. It wasn't that they didn't want to engage in games. And from the study that I referred to earlier, in where we put the computers in the homes of the older people, we found that two of the biggest applications that were used, one, of course, was email. The second was games, but those kinds of games were things that people were more familiar with, like solitaire and checkers and those kinds of things.
Thank you, Sarah. Anyone who wants to pose a question? Yes?
Hello, this is Tamra. I'm a product designer, and I specialize in design for all. And I worked recently a lot with elderly people and disabled people, like including them in the design process. And lately, I'm originally from Turkey, so lately I started to look at the migration issues because I think that there's a relation between how we solve the problems with like design for all method, or you call it inclusive design or human-centered design, participatory design, I don't know.
Can you formulate the question? We have.
So I wonder if you see a connection, like if we can apply our solutions dealing with aging population or disabled people in the way we deal with the migration issues today.
Thank you very much for that big question. Maybe we can come back to that later on. because now time is running out, and we have been talking about the technology very much from ICT, and there have been lots of various aspects of technology posted. But as a roundup, I would like to ask you to imagine that we are actually 15 years from now, and that means that we are in year 2030. And although it might be hard, it would be fun to make some betting, to look into that crystal ball and just try to select one technological innovation that will have had greatest impact for older people in year 2030. It's just a fun thing. You won't be evaluated.
You know, a good futurist predicts so far in the future that they're dead by the time they find out right. They're wrong. You know,
yeah. So who would like to begin? And you can be on any level you want.
Well, in my mind, that will then be the technologies for the network society, and specifically the fifth generation of mobile communication, 5G, that we're currently doing research and innovation on, where we will develop a system that has capabilities far beyond what we have today, much higher performance, but also being ultra-responsive, ultra-reliable, secure, sustainable, and that people can really trust.
Okay. Sarah?
I think it has to be the biotechnologies, the technologies that are going to sustain our bodies and basically stop us from becoming frail and dependent.
Biotechnology? And Joe?
That's a hard one to beat. Both of those are hard to beat. Just in part to be different or to say maybe they're equal. I think 15 years means the technology is already in somebody's laboratory and will be commercialized soon. So I'm going to go with robotics. It's going to not only enable us to stay in our homes longer, but it's going to enable people to replace the workers that don't exist in countries because of fertility rates down, but also enable older workers to stay on the job longer to take those tasks that may be a strain on their bodies.
So finally, Sarah.
I think those obviously are three big trends we have, and I think there's going to be a lot more in sensing technologies. And I think technology is going to become more hidden, how shall we say. It's going to be less intrusive, so it'll be much more integrated. We won't even be thinking about it as much.
Science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke said the technology that works best works like magic and is invisible.
Exactly.
Okay, well, time flies, and we might meet again in year 2030 to see who was right. So please give a warm applause to Sarah, Joe, Sarah and Sarah.
Innovation. And you.
Sorry, I think
Como el debate es ahora sobre las percepciones, si ellos creen que eso es una percepción general, o sea, si la gente lo está viendo así y que efectivamente como se puede usar. ¿Cuál era? Stick to the 20-25 minutes.
Nollställer ni klockan här också? Yes.
Så
So you're more than welcome also to further come down, close to the front line here. If you, it's easier also if you have questions, we might just give you the microphone. So, anyone? Okay. Welcome to this 45-minute session, and it's on changing attitudes on elderly. And I believe it's an intriguing theme, and probably it has never been more important than now, as the age quake is hitting us right now. So my name is Suki Choi, and I'm delighted to have on board Professor Laura Carstensen, Professor Ursula Staudinger, Professor Martin Kohli, and Professor Naohiro Ogawa. So let's start with the first question. I was going to ask Martin if you would like to be the representative of Europe as German and say that...
German, sorry, Italian, Swiss.
You are multi-European, obviously EU representative. So it would be interesting for us to share your view on the general attitude to the elderly right now.
Well, the attitude towards the elderly is not the problem. It's elderly are respected, and they are not seen as the ones that use up our resources. On the other hand, aging as such is largely seen as a problem, societal aging. And I have just looked at the Pew survey in 21 countries, not only Europe. If you ask people how large of a problem is the growing number of older people in your country, those who say it's a very large, it's a major problem, are the leaders, Japan, second place, South Korea, and third place, China. Then come some European countries, and the US is very low.
Right at the bottom.
US is optimistic, but it's also a reflection about the factual aging of the population. We see that the East Asian societies are the ones that will age most rapidly over the next 50 years. So people see this as a problem, not elderly people as individuals.
Okay. So your reflections on that, Ursula, do you have any comment? Do you agree?
Well, obviously, the rapidity with which demographic change hits a country makes an impression on the population in that country. And anything that comes with force is intimidating. And that is then reflecting on to the cause of this intimidation, which is the older part of the population. But coming back to your original question, attitudes towards older people and later adulthood, I think we are still dealing around the world, actually, with a one-sided negative age stereotype that we carry in our heads about what old people are like. So old people are outdated, old people are forgetful, old people are slow, old people are rigid, not open, inflexible, old people are sick, and most of all get demented. And so this is summarizing this one-sided negative age stereotype, which is with us, unfortunately, also part of it in our own heads. And there's this great research that shows us the more we believe or fear this to be true, it actually becomes true. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy in a very unfortunate way. And so I'm afraid to say that there is a great need for societal change to take place in order to amend this one-sided negative stereotype. For instance, we've done a recent study that shows in countries where the labor force participation of older people is higher than in other countries, we see that the perception of older people has changed in being competent rather than incompetent. So a stereotype is not completely detached from reality. It is reflecting reality, but with a time lag. And so the more we build a reality that enables older people to show what they can and to contribute to society, right, we will also then see a change in these views.
Thank you. And we talked about East Asia, and in fact, being double cultural myself, I was born in Sweden, grew up by South Korean parents. I always said that I want to grow old in East Asia, because you can feel in the atmosphere, the value system is that you look up to the wisdom, you bow. It's beautiful if you go into a bus, people just stand up if there is someone that needs a seat. And I just wonder, Professor, well, Ogawa, could you describe the attitudes towards the elderly in East Asia and Japan, and maybe contrast it
now
to...
Now or the past?
Well, please, begin with the past, then you go into
You know, according to, well, Japan had the first civil war, I mean, civil right, civil code, early, I would say, the end of, the middle of the 19th century. According to the old civil code, the elderly, I mean, the head of the household had all the power, making arranging the marriage for the elder son. Like that, when they choose the spouse for the elder son, they choose the spouse for the son who might be willing to live with them. You know, as make sure that they're willing to co-reside with the parents when they get old. So, but that, you know, the legal, I would say legal power is gone because the civil code was changed.
So how is it now?
Now it's up to the children. You know, the arranged marriage has been, back in 1960s, two-thirds of marriage are arranged. It's 1960, you know? But after that, it's keeping falling. Right now, only 3% of marriage are arranged. Rest of all, love marriage. So parents have nothing to do with the marriage, kids' marriage. So they can't really control that. But, you know, if you look at the Japanese history, this is a co-residence, the multi-generational living arrangements, and also with the heavily dependent on the familial transfers. These are the key of the part of the family life. In fact, the household had all the authority in controlling these things. But it seems to be changing quite a bit. And so definitely, as you said, Japan used to be age-graded society, which was reflect even the labor market. You know, back the we had this what you call age seniority or seniority oriented society pay scale. Once you get older, you get a higher wage. Right. So you know, but that seems to be sort of disappearing because now we're in the middle of this global economy, and we have to compete with other countries which are highly competitive. So this the enumerations the system has the remuneration system has been adjusted quite a bit. I mean, it's more ability oriented rather than age oriented. So the in that sense, the elderly person tend to get the lower wages, not as high as before. So sort of losing the economic power. But I would say that in fact, data shows elderly persons are quite rich. They have accumulated huge assets. So that's, I think I talked about this, presented this morning, but you know, the Japanese elderly person don't get the family support or family transfers until age 81. 25 years ago, that was 64. You know, the reason is that they don't need money. They have pension, they have accumulated assets. So in fact, they give resources back to children. You know, and our concept is that you know the children tend to support the elderly. The elderly persons. You know, the transfer should be from the children to the elderly. I mean, when elderly parents are retired, they need the financial support from children because one of the major utilities of having children is old age security. So they have kids because they need some old age security. And that's the reason why parents have kids. But that seems to be reversed, and now that the elderly give the resources to the children because children have high unemployment problems. So, in fact, this position, the economic position of elderly seems to be sort of raised to a considerable extent because of this increased uncertainties in the economic world.
I'm so happy that you said that the value of older people still might be high due to the increasing economic power. So I might go to Asia still. Yeah. Yeah. So the wisdom of the elderly is something that we haven't not talked so much about, touch upon. But I know that you, Ursula, have been digging into that. And Laura, maybe you can also later on have a comment on the knowledge and the definition of knowledge. As we, you know, have attitude to the elderly.
Do you want to start?
Laura,
Ursula,
do you want to?
Has done an enormous amount of research on wisdom, per se. You should speak about that.
Oh, okay. So, when it comes to wisdom, it's a very difficult subject matter because it's the pinnacle of human existence, right? It has been described across the ages and across many different cultures as the most important body of insight and judgment that you can attain as a human being. And some cultures even claim as a human you cannot have it because it is beyond human nature. And so nevertheless, we have tried in the 1980s to develop an empirical paradigm. We are researchers, right? So we try to develop an empirical paradigm to measure something like wisdom. And we have defined it as an outstanding body of insight and judgment when it comes to very difficult and fundamental issues of life. For instance, issues of the vulnerability of human existence with regard to sickness, but also with regard to its terminality, or fundamental issues like sexuality, fundamental issues like we need others at the same time we want to be independent.
Right.
So this dialectic between closeness and autonomy, all of these are fundamental issues of life that occur whenever human beings are alive. They come in different disguises, quote unquote, in historical times and in different cultures, but the basic pattern of the problem stays pretty much the same. And we've come up with some criteria that allow us to evaluate which kind of judgment might be better and which one may be less good when it comes to these difficult problems. For instance, it plays an important part whether we are aware of the uncertainties of life and we can deal with that uncertainty, that we never know what will happen for sure, that we never know why things happened in the past, for instance. And now when you do this kind of examination, you find that, unfortunately, as we move through adult life, it is not enough to grow older, to just grow older, to become wiser. There, some other things need to come into play to help the experiences that we make as we get older to come to fruition with regard to wisdom. And for instance, just let me give you one example. One thing that needs to come in addition to growing older is that we maintain an openness to new experiences. And why is that? Well, if we make a certain experience, we draw our conclusions, we have an insight, we think we know how it goes, so we have a piece of advice, right, that we can give to other people. But what happens to this piece of advice if it's not challenged by new things that happen in the world? And this openness to new experience helps us to update our previous insights. And then actually, the older we get, we are in a much better position to give wise advice because we have multiple instances to compare with. But if we don't keep an open mind, there is a tendency, unfortunately, to become dogmatic and to just know how the game is played.
Right. And Laura, I was going to ask, do you want to add something to the portrayal of the current attitudes to the elderly?
You know, I've been listening to my colleagues talk and thinking sort of in a broad historical sense. I think we have great ambivalence about aging and older people because old age itself is relatively new. So we have had long-lived people for as long as we have recorded history, but very, very few. And then all of a sudden, we have this new stage in life that's become normative, typical. So most people are old mm-hmm. today will reach this stage in life in the developed world. But we don't have clear roles. Right. And I think, you know, when you think historically how things have changed, they've changed with Social Security, pension policies. And in some ways, they've changed because you say if we support older people as a class of people, we create an old age welfare state. You know, we say, well, older people are needy, they deserve to be taken care of. And that doesn't create very positive images of a group, whatever that group is. And ironically, some of the strongest advocates for older adults have created some of the negative stereotypes, you know, saying they're vulnerable, they're needy, and so on. So we have that right. conversation going. And then as we've come to create this more normative stage right. in life, we now have a lot of people saying, myself included, and I think a lot of us, we need all hands on deck. We need older people to be engaged, involved in workplaces, communities, families. So now we're changing, and now these attitudes are getting very positive. So we have this mix, yeah. and it's fluid, but I think if you look at it, if you just zoom out and think how new it is that right. we've had this typical stage in life, it kind of makes sense that we're still right. confused
so
of what it's like.
So it's some kind of transitional phase that
yeah.
we are in. So,
yeah, I think so.
And I know that I have some in the digital audience that wants to put a question, and then we will move on also to the analog audience. So please.
Yeah, in regards to perception towards the elderly, we have received a couple of comments from the online audience. The first one is from Spring Star from India. She says, aging should be seen as a natural phenomena. And then in the same line of thought, we have a comment from Stockholm 87, who says, the older are the only natural resource in the world that is growing. So... yes. So what can be done so that the society shifts towards this kind of perception, that the elderly are indeed a resource, something productive and not something to support? Do you have any ideas how can this change?
Please, Laura.
Yeah, I mean, I keep thinking in historical terms. We live in a world that was built quite literally by and for young people. That's the culture that guides us. That's the physical environment. That's the depth of the stairs we go up and so on. This is a young world. And the social norms that guide us through life are norms that evolved around lives half as long. I think one of the most pressing challenges right now, historically, is to take the resource. Don't start with saying, are older people the same or as good as younger people are at X, Y, or Z? But to say, these are qualities that older people have. What are the roles that could benefit societies and families and communities that this resource could fill? And unless we build that, unless we build an infrastructure, channel factors, you know, pathways that people can take, I'm afraid we're going to end up with the creation of a society where we tell people to get out of the way, make way for younger people, go off, we'll take care of you, but we won't be able to afford to. And that's the problem. But we don't have to do that. We can create new roles right. and benefit dramatically from older people, I believe.
So it sounds like we have a great opportunity to redefine the roles. One more question. Yes, yeah. Martin.
No, I would like to ask first, maybe. But
yes.
I would like to come back on the East Asia, Europe issue. We often hear from our colleagues from East Asia, well, you treat your elderly awfully. You don't support them in the family, etc., etc. Your families are really being destroyed, and we are certainly much happier with our maybe neo-Confucian family system.
Mm-hmm.
It's not quite true that what we see even in Europe is very strong families still. It may be changing, the change may be coming, but up till now we also see the same things as you did with the transfers from parents to children and so on and so forth. But the interesting thing is that there is are quite systematic differences among countries and regions within Europe. So for instance, in co-residence of old elderly parents with their adult children, in Scandinavia it's 5%, in Southern Europe it's 31%. So Italy is very close to Japan, including with the problems of low fertility and so on and so forth.
We have low fertility too.
Yeah, so it sounds like we have cultural differences, of course, affecting the attitude to the elderly.
Yes, but I also, as you were speaking and as Laura was speaking, I was thinking, I think we should not make the mistake to wish ourselves back to in a time where maybe there was more respect and reference towards older people. Because there they were unique exemplars. And I think some of the respect had to do with that, you know, sort of like making reference to this outstanding thing that someone grew that old. Mm-hmm. But now being old is a mundane, is a normal thing. So now what do we have to do? Uh-huh. We cannot, you know, ask for this respect. It's just, it doesn't fit. Okay. It's also actually turning around and being stigmatizing. Right. And so I think the society of longer lives has to look for each and every phase in life and has to figure out what are the strengths and the weaknesses that each and every phase in life has. Yeah. And then find ways to institutionalize to make the most of the strengths and hopefully find ways to compensate, maybe even across the different generations, for the weaknesses. Mm. It is not the case that the young 25-year-old worker is the gold standard of productivity. It is not. When you look at sick leave days, the sick leave days of the 25 to 30-year-olds are higher than the sick leave days of the 55 and 60-year-olds. Why? Because no children, but also there are, you know, Black Mondays because you partied over the weekend, and there are Free Fridays because you prepare for the weekend. Right. And so you have your priorities in life are quite different, and rightfully so, because you're there to make it, to find partners, to create a family, and to, you know, be out and cheerful. And midlife and then later life has a different motivational setup and different goals. And we are not very good yet, neither as employers nor as societies, to make the most of these strengths that we bring out of every phase in life. And so coming round circle, in a society of longer lives, we need to learn to have respect for the 5-year-old, for the 15-year-old, for the 30-year-old, for the 50, for the 70, all for right. the 80, and the 100-year-old, in the very same way. And really, actually, I think we need to understand each other better. You know, get away from the mutual stereotypes.
Thank you. So it would imply that we need to update the Asian model. So I know we have an question. Is that something you want to comment on? Was just a...
No, I just want to say one thing, not directly to that, but you know, one thing I'm worried about is this. You know, I said elderly are rich now in Japan, but it's on the average.
Okay.
There are tremendous differences within the group, elderly persons, and some are very poor, some are well, super wealthy, and so this is one of the problems. And on top of that, recently we had this 2008. We had a Lehman shock, right? The worldwide impact. At that time, Japanese elderly, I mean, rich elderly person, got really suffered. They had a huge investment, but they lost quite a bit. In fact, the transfer from the elderly to the children dropped in that particular year. So, in other words, for elderly rich, but they have to know a lot about a financial handling. Knowledge. I mean, they should have more knowledge on the financial matters. Now, according to the OECD data, in Japan, the 57% of the adults have no knowledge on the financial products, and 71% of the Japanese adults have no knowledge on bonds and securities. It's a bit, you know, serious, I mean, the problem for Japan. We should educate all these people. And the elderly, once they get this, you know, more knowledge on the financial matter, the handling, then they can make more money, in fact. They could be richer, and they can really support the Japanese economy.
Yeah.
They help the younger people. You know, these days, pension is very, very stable source of income. whether the economy is depressed or not, they still get the same amount of the money is coming in. But for the younger, their adult children, they might lose a job any time. They have more serious problem if the economy is depressed. That's exactly what happened in the during the Japan last decade, which started 1990. For the more than 20 years, Japan had a recession. At that time, a lot of people lost a job. And then 2008, we got the Lehman shock, and then elderly suffered quite a bit. So intergenerational flow of resources sort of got stuck in that particular year. But to me, I think elderly are rich, but they should know more about the money.
Okay.
So that they can be more helpful to the society.
Okay. Thank you very much,
to
Hiro.
To the young.
I know there is a very eager question from the audience that we should post.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Yeah, my name is Benjamin Benedict Ekwaba. I was listening to you people. This is fascinating. I want to take it up from you, Dr. Osla, when you mentioned about wisdom, that we don't have to be very we don't have to be very dogmatic, so we should open ourselves to new innovation. I think for the Nobel Dialogue is about sharing ideas, looking at how to take all of humanity up, all of us, not some people, everybody up. And that means we have to continue to facilitate the exchange of ideas. Looking at the Western societies, I have seen they have systematized everything. But from sub-Saharan Africa, where I come from, I have also seen some cultural values that are very, very highly valuable in terms of the way we look at old people, the way we look at their aging process and how we can do to support them. You must create systems to support them, but beyond systems, you must also create love around them. Because we did hear here that even when you are happier, you live longer. So the key challenge is not about getting old. The key challenge is, how do I get old gracefully and happily? Because I think there are quite a lot of things that can be learned. It's unfortunate that we
Do you have a question or is
A comment? It's a comment, but I think there are quite a lot of things that can be learned. And I also feel that in as much as the life expectancy hasn't reached that much, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, are there studies currently ongoing that is looking at these value systems, both in Japan and everywhere, how old people are done.
So we need the question.
So that we can incorporate it into how to make the society generally better for everybody. So while we borrow the technology from the West, they borrow some good values also from Japan and other places. That's what I was thinking about. Thank you.
Okay, so any comment?
There is another question.
Yes, okay. It seems like we all heard your interesting comment. So let's hear from the next one with the question.
I have a question. How technology can help to balance mental and physical aging? Or how we can stop the overlapping of mental...
That's very interesting question. But I think that the theme here is about the attitudes. And actually, that was really perfect for the former session about technology. So
we got the chance.
Yeah. So the digital audience, do you have a question?
Yes, we have another question from the digital audience. We were commenting that maybe the elderly are not seen as a resource. And I'm thinking that that might be because the skills that they possess might be deemed as outdated. So Christopher Espinosa from France is saying the following. We usually alternate work and study for young students, giving obvious benefits. Why not for the elder? Why not for the elderly?
Okay.
I couldn't agree more.
Yeah.
It's so necessary. I couldn't agree more. That's what I said this morning. It's we have to have a continuous flux of learning spurts and then working periods and then learning spurts and private life. We just need to have a new mesh of life. And that is very true what our digital participant said here. I think one problem we currently have is that we left people out of the learning loop for a long time. So we get our final certificate, whatever it is, whether we were an apprentice or we did something, and then we do our job and we do it year by year and year by year. And then all of a sudden we turn 55 and the employer says, oh, by the way, Mr. Smith, I've all forgotten about you, but now you need to take some training to be really up to date. And then everyone is surprised that this Mr. Smith doesn't quite feel like learning. And the causality is then attributed to chronological age. But the problem of that story is not chronological age, is to let people out of the learning loop to start with. If we get out of practice with something, we lose the skill to do it. It's, you know, you learn to ride the bicycle. If you haven't done it for 20 years, you're quite, you know, uncertain on top of the bicycle. But if you continue to ride the bicycle, you are very well to do it. And that's what the research finds. We are very well able to continue to learn if we don't get out of practice.
Yes, Ciro?
I think the elderly could be more useful in fact as human resources. If I did some exercise, you know, we have so many healthy elderly persons. If they work, the Japanese GDP per capita will increase about 2.5 times in the next 20 years or so. So that's really the great improvement in terms of economic life. Mm. So we should really keep them in the labor force so that they keep on working. But unfortunately, because of this, the age limit system, they are forced to retire. That's just wasting resources.
And that actually implies the bigger question of whether we should increase and when the retirement age. Again, we come back to the importance of the legal system supporting the demographic development. Martin?
We have some research now, for instance, by James Heckman, who was a Nobel Prize in economics some years ago, which says you should all invest in education in the very young. The younger, the earlier, the better. The investments will pay off more. But we also need to see that it's important to invest all over the life course, even though the period for which you can then use it may be shorter. But instead of saying the earlier the better, we should say it's never too late.
The longer the better.
Yeah.
And I'm happy to actually informed that in Sweden they have a university for seniors. Yeah. And obviously that headmaster is saying that the knowledge thirst is just immense. Mm-hmm. And also the economic power we talked about is very vivid among those who are born 40s and onwards. Mm-hmm. So I was asking that with the economic power, they will not accept, at least the studies I've taken part, the current elderly care services. And they invest in lifestyle to increase life quality. They are willing to pay for services. And in Sweden, there is this discussion of having new segmentation. We cannot just talk about the elderly from the retirement age. Rather, they call it golden age or the new teenagers. And they want to work. They want to contribute. And the implication on this, on the attitude to the elderly, what would you say? How important is the aspect of actually letting in this win-win situation, Laura?
Well, I think this is—it's essential that we do something. But I mean, it's coming from all directions. So there are some people who want to retire. There are some people who want to work longer, and then we have employers. And an awful lot of employers are not interested in having older workers. They're too expensive because of a kind of a tradition of having incomes go up with seniority. And they are. So, I mean, you have to start to think about new models of how people work. Mm. But there's nothing that says you have to work in a way where you cost your employer more. A lot of older people would exchange flexibility and part-time work for a great deal of income, for example, and be able to come to pursue different kinds of jobs and careers, second careers that might give more meaning and less income. So if we can establish, again, social norms that allow people to do that, and then structural pathways like education systems and university retraining and so on, then people would be able to begin to sort of reconstruct their lives.
Right. And just touching upon your research on the socio-emotional theory, it seems like the shorter lifespan you have as you grow older, you change your attitude. Mm-hmm. So what's the implication for the general attitude of the society?
If we can tap this, I think the potential here is enormous. If you study, survey, ask people 50 and older about work, about what they care about the people they care about. They care about things that really matter, important issues. And they're less concerned about their own individual career paths. They've reached the peak of their career and passed it, and now they say, I want to do something that matters. When you've got millions and millions of older people around the globe who are saying, I want to do something that matters. Yeah, let's say okay. Can I add one? Oh, we did a survey recently of older people who were to ask them if they were volunteers or not volunteers, and if they weren't, we asked them why they didn't volunteer. And in the top three reasons, I can't remember if it was second or third, of not volunteering was nobody ever asked. Hmm. And we need to start asking. That's what.
So there seems to be a sleeping demand.
Yeah.
And
or a sleeping resource, I think, maybe more. The demand needs to be woken up.
And the question then, contrast to that, is the attitudes to the elderly, as you also have the factor dementia, the fact that the degenerative diseases mm-hmm. are multiple diseases that also make it a social and economic burden.
Yeah.
If this is creating some kind of more, let's say, negative attitudes to the elderly, how shall you mix and counterbalance that to this actually positive and resourceful attitude to the elderly?
Well, I think, as I said in the beginning, it's old age is multifaceted. It's not only good and it's not only bad. And certainly our bodies become more vulnerable for sicknesses and morbidity, and that's including our brain, because the biology is not optimized for these longer lifespans. But there are the positive sides, which we have discussed, with the motivational attitude, the emotional life, the experience that people bring with it. And it's both true. And for the changes in our bodies and in our brains, we have to pay attention to the fact that as our societies develop, the toll that time takes of our bodies seems to be less and less. So we have been doing a pretty good job in our societies to protect the bodies. And I think we will do more and more. And in our previous session in technology, we touched upon regenerative medicine. Right. And I think this will be a part in medicine that will gain in importance to sort of like not only exchange joints to help us continue to walk and stuff, there will be more things that help us with morbidity. And I have talked about some of the research that makes us actually hopeful when it comes to protecting our brains. And so step by step, we can hope that this negative attitude is, how should I say, becoming more porous, so that people are willing to see, yes, there's a risk, but there are also things I can do to protect myself. Mm-hmm. And then I think that will create some change.
Okay.
On the other hand, some people are sick.
That's true.
And we can't make it go away for everyone. So this is also an issue in age of retirement. Mm. We can't make everyone healthy and fit and willing to work until 70 or 75. So we have to have a realistic attitude about what can be changed and how we cope with what can't be changed, at least not in the short run. Mm.
Yes,
this is a really important point, and I think there often sounds like there are two voices, the positive voices about aging and the negative ones. Aging societies will have more of many more resources in older, talented, healthy people, and we will also have more people who are frail and sick. And that's between individuals, but it's also within individuals. Most of us in long-lived eras of life are going to spend some period of time where we are dependent on others and we are sick. Most of us will. So it's not just some of us will and some of us won't. Yeah. It's most of us will need services and help. Hopefully we can limit that period of time as best we can, but we need both more supports and more channels to tap the resource.
And I find it so interesting, you know, that this very true thing that you just described, that there is both room for productivity yeah. and room for dependency. It's very true for the beginning of life, yes. for instance, yeah. when we look at infants, toddlers, children, right. and no one ever thinks or talks or discusses the fact that there's big dependency. And we have developed, and we get even better step by step, infrastructure to take care of that. And it's a natural part. But no one would challenge for that reason the meaning and the purpose of that phase in life. And so it's we need to think more circular. About life as a yeah. circle. Yes.
And it's kind of interesting to hear that we accept the law of nature reality for the infants. They are dependent. But we don't have the same valuation yet. Yeah. And the burden and contribution, it seems to be a very important dilemma and a paradox that you might deal with. And Hiro, I know that you have been looking into policies and so forth. And how much...
My last comment is that for Japan, the elderly are the savior. Could be savior, because I did some exercise. We have this labor earning profiles. The peak is 51. Okay, if you just shift this peak, you know, by 9 years, in the next 45 years, okay, then Japan can stop the further aging. Mm-hmm. So it seems to be that, you know, this labor market change or response seems to be quite important. This involves the greater participation of elder persons in the labor force. So
I was thinking, since it's Christmas time, and I thought you would choose one key actor. It doesn't have to be the government, but a key actor that is very important in shaping our minds regarding the elderly. Who would it be, and what Christmas wish, a message would you send to that key actor in order to improve the attitudes to the elderly? Laura, do you want to begin?
Employers. I've kind of given up on the government in the United States is solving these big issues, because we seem to be paralyzed and unable to do anything. And if the government was going to fix it, they would have had to start years ago. So I think things are going to percolate up. I think it's going to be bottom up, these changes. But employers, workplaces, we spend most of our waking hours in workplaces for most of our lives, tremendous opportunity to do things. And if employers could appreciate that there are increasingly well-documented spillover effects of having older workers and workforces to younger people's productivity, that would help.
Ursula?
I certainly second that, but I would also say I hope and wish that the baby boom generation around the developed world really grasps the opportunity and defines for themselves a new kind of old age. And then, if that happens, they will make a major impact by the sheer numbers. So I would like to really wish them the liberty and the self-confidence to find new lifestyles in old age.
Okay. Martin, who would you send your Christmas message to?
Well, it's hard after this to find another actor.
You are allowed to repeat.
I say it should be political actors, including the government, not only top-down, but also bottom-up, social movements, parties. This has to be also done in terms of policy, and that's where the public domain really makes a huge impact.
Okay, finally, Hiro.
Well, I think, I hope the government will do something, but, according to the my empirical studies, it's quite clear that the government hasn't responded that fast. Private sector, including families, are much more flexible to cope with this problem of population aging. So I'm hoping, I wish the Merry Christmas to family and the private sector. Thank you.
Okay. So employers, government and policymakers and the family, and I would like to send a wish to you sitting here. You've heard all the wisdom, and I think the grassroots movement of youth starting to change attitude is also very important. So thank you for having joined us, and a big applause to the great panel.